Honey, where are my socks? Honey, where are my socks? Honey, where? What the f***?
What you just heard is me doing an impersonation of the laugh from one of the villains of the movie I am now reviewing, and just got back from a few minutes ago, and that is Crank High Voltage, the sequel to the Jason Statham thriller action film a couple years ago, also called Crank. It's funny because I'm actually one of the few people I know, at least anyone that I've spoken to, that actually really, really loved and enjoyed the first film. Most people I've talked to, both family, friends, and otherwise, have hated the first film because they said it was mindless, senselessly violent and lewd, and completely nonsensical. Which is fine to me because this movie is pretty much more of the same in assloads of spades. Crank High Voltage is brought to you by Lionsgate Films. It was directed and written by the same people who made the first Crank, Mark Neville Dean and Brian Taylor. Stars Jason Statham, Amy Smart, Clifton Collins Jr., David Carradine, and Ling Bai. The plot. Picking up almost immediately after the first film, left Chev Chelios, played by Jason Statham, falls to his apparent death from a helicopter fight in the first film. However, instead of dying, he is scooped up almost immediately after by triad gangsters and taken to an undisclosed facility where he is operated on and has his heart replaced with an artificial one. Turns out the Triad Gang wishes to save their ailing 100-year-old mob boss, Poon Dong, played by David Carradine, by replacing his aging heart with Chev Chelios' indestructible heart, and giving Chev an artificial heart so they can keep him alive long enough to harvest the rest of his organs for their boss. However, Chev wakes up, escapes, and now goes on a murderous killing spree of rampage, sex, and more lewd behavior as he tries to get his heart back and get it switched so he can survive. However, his heart has a limited battery span, so he must constantly keep himself rejuvenated by having electrical shocks long enough to survive. Review of the plot. Just saying the movie's plot out loud makes it just as ridiculous as the first film. The first film actually borderlined some reality. It had some kooky craziness, but managed to keep the span of reality, or at least plausibility, a little better than most films. However, Crank High Voltage pretty much takes that, throws it to the wind, spits on it, takes a giant monkey crap on it, pisses on it, rapes it, and then throws it back again. This movie is completely off-the-wall balls bonker. It's completely insane and ridiculous, and the movie knows it. One thing I like about this movie is that it does not make any attempt or take any time in the film to acknowledge any kind of seriousness. This movie knows it's outrageously ridiculous, and it makes no attempt to hide it. It knows it's crazy, it knows it's silly, so it does it in full force, full frontal nudity craziness. I mean, this, if anyone thought the first film of Crank was outrageous, then this film pretty much takes that and sticks a giant needle of testosterone, crack cocaine, and shoves it up the first movie's ass, and just causes an explosion of outrageousness. That's the best way I can explain this movie, because there is so much going on. There is literally countless amounts of nudity, swearing, sexual scenes, and unbelievably ridiculous gore that it's impossible to take this movie seriously. And I applaud them for taking a completely ridiculous concept and not trying to keep it serious. And by keeping it silly. That's smart, and not trying to make the movie something it's not. A review of the characters. One of the definite benefits of this film over the first one was the expansion of a much larger variety of characters. There are many more gangs and individuals that interact around this movie, whereas there's a rather limited amount in the first film. You got, like, the aging gangster, Poon Dong. You got Clifton Collins Jr., who plays a criminal known as the Ferret, quite well, actually, though he doesn't give as much credit as he should. Ling Bai, playing Rhea, the crazy-ass Asian hooker who speaks pretty much throughout the entire film in broken, obscene, swearing subtitles. You got Amy Smart, who is even more enjoyable and definitely much more embracive as Eve. She definitely has dropped the bubbliness from her first film's character and expanded on her role. And, of course, then you have Jason Statham as Chev Chelios, who just is basically an even more crazier, coked-up, amped-up version of himself from the first film, which is fine because that's what I enjoyed about him most, was his zaniness. And, like I said, it was so nice to have so many more characters to interact with. There's so much more going on, so many different people you can go to, different situations arise from these different characters. It doesn't feel limited at all. It just feels much more expansive, and they make full well use of their characters. Even the Doctor from the first film gets much more screen time. He gets to do more, and it was just such a great improvement on everything that made the first movie good and just quadrupled it. review of the music and cinematography. Fair warning that if you don't like shaky, you know, camera angles and just weird camera shots, then stay away from this film because this film is loaded with it. I mean, Crank barely touched upon the unique, bizarre style that these directors seem to like to use with their video game-esque like intros and bizarre cut angles and camera angles. This movie is overloaded with it, and so much to the point that it's almost kind of like a head trip. The music is absolutely bizarre, and it's really neat because this music was done by Mike Patton, who is the former lead singer of Faith No More. I believe he's also in a band called Mr. Bungle. Not sure about that, but he did the whole music for this film. And it's definitely noticeable because it's much more bizarre and almost circus-like. And it fits because this movie is like one big crazy circus. It's so constant and just constantly moving and jumping and in your face that it's so hard not to get sucked into this movie because it makes it so hard not to have fun. Anyone who sees this movie will at least have a little bit of fun by the absolute zaniness of the constant music and weirdness of the film. It's a very unique film, just like the first one was. It was directed very uniquely, and so this movie follows quite well. Cons about the film. The only problem with this movie, by having it so zany, is that, unfortunately, it takes away from, again, like, the plausibility of the first film. And at times, as much as I am a stout supporter of zaniness, I'm always up for a good silly film or silly stuff, this movie even pushes the boundaries on even what I would consider plausible. I mean, we're talking some really weird stuff, like science fiction B-movie stuff almost to the point. There's two scenes in particular, one inviting a fight during some high-voltage showers, and one involving a little surprise towards the end of the film involving the ferret character played by Clifton Collins Jr., that it's just almost jaw-dropping how bizarre this film can get. And unfortunately, at times, it kind of deters from the reality of taking this movie at least a little bit with a grain of salt, because it makes it so much harder to take everything you've seen. The other downside is that it definitely moved away from the plausibility of a structured storyline in the first film. The first film tried to make it at least a little bit more serious, and that kind of made it more dramatic, whereas here it was mostly, you know, humorous, which is fine, but it's kind of a shame when the film started, I felt so strongly in the first series by being serious and then going, you know, totally the crazy town. So yeah, those are my little personal beefs with the film. Final wrap-up. The film definitely requires a lot of salt-taking and Vicodin-taking. You have to realize that this movie is not supposed to be taken seriously. It's absolutely insane asylum outrageous. There's so much silliness and nuttiness and zaniness that there's no way in freaking hell, heaven, or high water that you can take this movie serious for one split second. It's designed to be silly and crazy. And if you're not into that, then by all means, do not see this film. You cannot see this movie the same way you see other films because it's that bizarre. And in that regard, I was quite happy with it because it didn't try to make it seem like it was something else. You knew what you were getting into when you saw the film, when you bought the ticket, and I was quite pleased with that. The characters, much more vibrant, much more variety of characters. Music and camera angles are very unique. It was a hysterical movie with awesomely ridiculous amounts of gore, violence, and nudity. I was completely flabbergasted at how crazy this movie was. I had so much fun, so much shock. I give Crank High Voltage 4 stars out of 5. Alright, that's all for now. I hope you've enjoyed listening to my review. This is Bionic Slime, signing off, and bye for now.